Well, welcome back, and I hope you all had a good holiday. I enjoyed my visit to Capitol Hill last night and appreciated the warm reception there also.
That's the best speech you ever made.
Thank you very much. I've also sent my legislative bill to a message to the Hill outlining in more detail the programs that I talked about last night. And there's a summary of the message before you that sets forth our program of domestic and national security initiatives. This is going to be a challenging year, and I think we all know that. And I'm as determined as you are that it be successful for our country and for us as Republicans. I think the initiatives contained in this message will ensure continued peace and prosperity. And as I've told you over and over again, if we can just stick together as Republicans, then the voters will be able to tell the difference in November. As you know, I'm committed to sticking with our budget agreement that we negotiated last December, but I'll be more insistent than ever that Congress straighten out the budget process mess. As I said last night, I really meant it. I will not sign another 14-pound continuing resolution. I've always wondered what the hell it would be like if we closed down the government. But we simply must force the process to work as it was intended to, in an orderly way, with separate appropriations. And now, before I ask about your own schedules, I want to say that I'm glad that the Senate's hearings on the INF Treaty have gotten off to a fast start. George and Frank were both on the Hill testifying yesterday. Bob Dole made a strong statement to the Foreign Relations Committee as well. And I'm also pleased to note that the Senate Judiciary Committee intends to report the nomination of Judge Kennedy tomorrow. And I hope he can be confirmed before the Lincoln Day recess.
That'll be done.
Thank you. That's good. All right. I take it as gospel when I hear it from that source. And why don't you and Bob Michael give us a word on the Senate and House schedules, and then we'll turn to Central America for the time remaining and hear from George Shultz and Colin Powell.
Well, Bert plans to bring up Grove City, I think, this week. That'll be a long, drawn-out debate. Senator Hatch, Senator Thurmond, others, Senator Danforth will be leading efforts to.
I think we'll have to small talk here for a few minutes. We've got two waves of press coming in.
He didn't get a hernia picking up.
Somebody busted his finger, John.
Like to have.
Yes.
She really would.
I never heard of practice.
That's right.
I had just not heard the term.
Why are you right? Hello.
Mr. President. Mr. President, are you ready to give a figure on the contra aid yet?
Well, that's what we're going to discuss.
Does this be it?
This morning. And you'll be hearing about it very soon.
What do you think about last night's encounter between Vice President Bush and Dan Rather?
Only going to talk about the other encounter, contra.
You think he upstaged your State of the Union last night?
No comment.
You think Rather was too tough on the Vice President?
It's again, no comment.
Well, could you tell us what the Vice President said to you in confidence and help clear up some... You could get him off the hook, Mr. President, by telling us what the Vice President urged you about the Iranian arms sales.
No, I think he has been exactly right that would set a precedent with regard to private conversations between presidents and vice presidents, and I don't think we have a right to do that.
Nice, please.
Was he present when Schultz and Weinberger expressed their objections to this arms sale? There's some confusion about that.
No, he wasn't.
He was not present.
Mark.
Thank you.
Do you think it's civilized to break the arms and legs of protesters?
Is that
Mr.
Still doing that?
The Sandinistas and the Israelis are doing.
That's one of those questions that if I try to ignore it or something, I look hard-hearted and I'm opposed to violence wherever it's possible to avoid violence.
Thank you.
Thank you. This way, please.
So we're not going to have any legal aid then?
Keep him next to you.
I don't know if I'd be mad at
him. Keep him right by you.
Thank you, sir. I tried to call back.
John, you got the quarter of the week.
You know why I...
And eventually we get the money back and then we...
Who were sitting in his chair? That was...
The trouble that we had is that we had two divisions before World War II, right after World War II. We ended up with a brigade. About ready to close the whole army. Those are the largest bases in the world you've got. Had one brigade on.
Well,
it's a strange thing we here.
All of you have many demands on your time today. I thought it was important that we get together to discuss the package that I'll submit to Congress tomorrow to provide renewed assistance to the freedom fighters in Nicaragua. And I know that some of you have been in touch with George and Colin and Elliot and have provided valuable suggestions, and we've incorporated many of them in the package. In a moment, I'm going to ask George to give you a quick update on the situation in Central America as we now see it. And I'll ask Colin to describe the proposed legislation to you. It's my intention that we send up a responsible and workable package to sustain the freedom fighters in position and thereby enable them to serve as an essential insurance policy for Sandinista compliance with their latest promises. As I said to a group last week in the White House, the Sandinistas have opened the door to democracy, and we must close that door behind them and prompt them to move expeditiously to open the next door. So now let me turn to George and Colin, and then we'll have an open discussion.
Everybody here is quite familiar with the
opportunity for an Arabic people.
Well, listen, why don't we get one of seated over here as if we're doing an interview, which we've already
thank you very much. Thank you.
Get a photo here.
Really, the Arabic people need the pyramids in Haram. We need the pyramids.
We got it.
Yeah. The circulation is from the point of view. Please,
even publication.
Thank you very much. I think all our countries should leave by Thursday morning. So, and I think it would leave a very good effect on the Arab community. Thank you again. I know that you are very busy. But I hope you have a good to Thursday.
February 6th. Yes.
How do you feel before?
Consider the alternative of not having a birthday. We're looking forward to Mr. Mubarak's visit.
Thursday.
Yes.
I hope we can reach something substantial, especially for our area.
Sir, may I have one shaking? Mr. President, can I have one shaking, sir?
Senator Burstein.
It's a pleasure seeing you.
I'm President of Thai National Security.
Well, come in.
Thank you.
The Ambassador, how are you? Mr. Ambassador, how are you?
It's great.
It is indeed.
I was formal this time for having chosen Iceland because really. Thanks to you and that meeting, Iceland was put on the map in the world, so to speak.
Well, I was going to thank you for your hosting of our gathering there and how pleasant it was. And I think it led directly to finally the signing of the treaty that
yes.
Is going to mean so much in our world.
Yes, we realize that now, and we are very happy about it. That Reykjavik was the beginning, and I was mentioning that this morning. And when we think back now,
you are a very important segment.
Yes, we can't escape the fact that we are situated where we are situated. Stepping stone between the old and the new world. This is good. And becoming a stepping stone between the old world and the new world really opened up life in Iceland for us Icelanders. We jumped from the Viking Age to modern times.
You'll be back in May. You'll see an honorary degree at Smith-Dunlop.
Yes, thank you. You're very well.
My wife graduated from Smith.
Oh, I'm happy to hear that. So I'll be in her steps when I come down there.
Well, no, hers wasn't honorary.
No.
For going there 4 years and graduating.
Yes.
That is a very distinctive college and much admired and appreciated.